Antipsychotics in themselves are not horrible, but they are not a savior. They should not be used a lot. And from my perspective, it's the good, the bad, and the ugly. So what I wanted to just do really quickly is to show a show of hands who, of anyone who's worked with me, with patients who, after all the medication changes were done, the behavior got better. Is there anyone? Okay. So then is there anyone who, and basically I spend a lot of my time taking people off of Ativan, and I want to touch base on that later. Is there anyone who I've worked with where the behavior, and this is not, you know, planned, where the behavior was worse? I've had a few. Okay. I've also had a few people die within the first couple days of working with them, and frankly what I will say in this population is it's a complicated population. They can be very frail, they can be old, and when they have dementia, they may have things going on and not be able to communicate even without the medications that can lead to them to have an early decline and death. We don't want to help them along. So the antipsychotics, the good news is they can often reduce paranoia, delusions, and related behavior, and I'll show you the studies for that. The antipsychotics will hasten decline and could result in early death. So they are not FDA approved for use in dementia. There is a black box warning. With any family that I speak to, I talk to them that we are in a palliative role. We want to keep someone in as good a shape, but we are focusing on their quality of life. You know, I will not go to these unless I've tried everything else. So this means that I know that this might not go so well. So they do have a 2% increased stroke risk and a 1% increased sudden death risk. And used incorrectly, they are very dangerous. But what I'm hoping I will also convince you is that sleeping pills and the use of Ativan, particularly Xanax, anything in the benzos, can also be very dangerous and often. I have my little catchphrases that as I drive around doing house calls in the Bay Area, I say to myself, and one of them is, Xanax is the crack of benzos, okay? Never use Xanax, never ever. And I couldn't understand why it's so widely prescribed. And then I was looking through the literature and basically they say, well, you know, benzos shouldn't be used too much, but if you use benzos, use something short acting. Well, crack is short-acting. It's short-acting than cocaine. Xanax is very much like that. It's a quick high, and then it's a short decline, and makes people more agitated later. It's a three-time-a-day drug. If you're giving it once a day, you're putting them in withdrawal. If you're giving them Ativan, 1 milligram a day, you're putting them in withdrawal by the next day. So I would actually, Tony and I are actually on the same page about we don't want people over-medicated. We want to respect residents' rights. We just come at it in a slightly different way. And when I look at his baseball lineup, I would agree with the first one. I would agree that I like, if someone's anxious or irritable, well, actually, no, I won't. So Tony, I would change your lineup. The first one would be Tylenol and ice cream. Most of these people have knee arthritis, back arthritis, and it did not go away when they got dementia. It's still there. They may not be able to communicate it as well. So I like giving people who are more irritable some Tylenol, you know, give them that benefit of the doubt, particularly if they had trouble with arthritis before, and ice cream. I've had people stop eating, stop swallowing. I had one man who stopped swallowing, but he could have ice cream, and he lived on Ensure and ice cream for a year and a half. So if they don't eat anything else, most people will eat ice cream. Going on to the next slide. So when you're looking at agitation, it's important to know exactly what you're looking at. I'm sorry, I'm going to look down here, so I'm not going like that. The first thing you want to make sure is that it's not delirium. That is a medical emergency. So I'm not saying that all folks with delirium have to go to the ER and have to get a head CAT scan, a lumbar puncture, but you do have to look at the medications. I always look for a bladder infection and pneumonia because they may not have a cough, but it may be pneumonia that's causing a problem. And this has been well addressed other places, so I'm not gonna put too much more time into that. infection, you want to make sure, you know, bladder infections are common. But as when I was precepting, you know, a resident came to me and said, this guy with a temperature of 102 had a bladder infection because he had 5 white cells in his urine. That's not it. I mean, that's a whole different discussion that we won't go into now. But bladder infections are a problem. Pain. Pain is huge. I can't tell you how many times I've seen people not treated for their pain, but given, you know, a Haldol and Ativan to keep them quiet. I also will say, I use narcotics in dementia. Sometimes I use methadone in dementia. I use what is needed to treat their pain. And tramadol sometimes will help. Sometimes it makes them more agitated, and sometimes it makes them more out of it. I feel my temperature rising. Let's see. So the other things along with pain is the prostate. Now, gentlemen, as they get older, do you guys know what keeps growing as you get older? Your ears and your prostate, for those of you who have a prostate. I don't have it.
Does this make a difference?
So prostate, I have realized that there's a number of men who are getting more agitated because they have trouble urinating. I am a huge fan of earlier in dementia than later, using the laser TURP before people get so frail it's problematic, to decrease the problems instead of just giving them Flomax or finasteride and antispasm medications. The other thing I've run into is teeth. You know, I am guilty. There's people who are pretty irritable who, you know, the staff has trouble brushing their teeth. Everyone needs hygiene, and Tippy Snow has this cool hand over hand help them, you know, brush their teeth, which I think is really great. You have to check out her website. I'm not going to go into that more. And then the other is pressure ulcers. I noticed from Tony's slide of that nursing home, all those people were in wheelchairs and no one had gel cushions. Not that anyone should sit in one spot all day, but they need to change position every 2 hours. They need to be engaged. The first thing I would do with anyone who's agitated and walking is keep them walking. And Tony and I agree, you have too much medication if someone is sedated. Psych meds are not like vitamins, not like cardiac medications. You only need as much as you need to get rid of the dangerous behavior. If they're sedated, that's too much. Constipation. Constipation is huge. When people are more independent, they're not going to tell you. And you need to keep an eye on it. It can be really a cause of agitation, and also it can cause bowel perforation and trips to the emergency room and possibly death. And then I agree, you have the understimulation and overstimulation. Overstimulation in our case today could be that this woman had to go to assisted living when she was used to being by herself. That she had to go down to meals when she really liked to be by herself. Under stimulation, we really have to keep an eye on making sure that we help people with their hearing and their vision. I'm not a huge fan of hearing aids for folks with more advanced dementia and in facilities. Hearing aids will get lost. Those $2,000 or $3,000 hearing aids will get lost. I like the pocket talkers where you put on the headset and talk into it for people who have more serious hearing problems. And the last, and the hugest, and the one that we doctors aren't really doing our part on, is understanding what medications are causing the problems. So I don't like Xanax, I don't like Ativan, I never use sleeping pills. Keppra is the new medication that, you know, now you don't have to do levels like Dilantin, but Keppra can cause psychosis and agitation. All of the antispasmodic bladder pills will cause agitation, including the Detrol, the Ditropan, the Vesicare, the Sanctura, steroids. Steroids can make people crazy as a bed bug, make them stay up all night. And I would put onto this list, as I was at a conference yesterday and went to a new coffee shop, Hills, who makes handcrafted coffees. I asked for my decaf French roast, and I don't know if they slipped me the regular, but I was up at 3 a.m. So no one with dementia needs caffeine. Okay, I don't have dementia, but I don't need caffeine either. I might sound a little caffeinated, but I'm not. And then the The other one is alcohol. In our culture, we have the habit, you know, the ritual of the 5 o'clock cocktail, particularly for the greatest generation. My generation has other habits, but, you know, and people keep asking me, how about marijuana to treat behavioral problems? And I'm like, there may be good studies, but I don't want to go there. So I would say when it comes to alcohol, you want to water the hard liquor. And I don't know that I'd want watered wine. So there, what often we do is we pour, for more high-functioning folks, pour the non-alcoholic wine into the alcoholic wine bottles and give them the wine bottle cork and say, oh, it's a new supplier, and then you can give them a little beer. So the other thing that I find very important, and I don't have bipolar, but I'm trying to get through this quickly, is to understand what are the goals of care. There's too many moving parts here. You want to work to define the particular symptom. You know, I'll never let a nurse or a caregiver say, well, they're agitated. Well, that could be anything from repetitive asking to go home or asking when dinner was to, like, you know, giving a sucker punch to another resident in the dining hall, which happened to one of my patients a week or so ago. You always want to work on the behavioral issues. I can't do my job. In fact, I see all of you as the cake, and I see us doctors as the frosting. We are there. We only can help take the edge off. In some cases, when people are really agitated, then we, or they're very psychotic, then we step in and we have more to do with the medications. But it's always after behavioral issues we try. If you are going to use medications, start low and go slow, and I mean seriously low. I'm talking about, you know, for antidepressants, I'll start with 5 or 10 of Celexa at night because it's sedating. That's citalopram. I only use Ativan when someone has to transfer to a facility because that's tough, and that's only for like 3 days, or for active death. I must say that, you know, when I die, I don't want to be there. I want to be off in a cloud of morphine and Ativan. And other than that, I really don't use Ativan. The folks that have worked with me know that. And also, global assessment is very crucial. You need to know what the family's seeing, what the facility's seeing, what other parties are seeing. Here is, you can come back to this later, this is Sherritt Inouye, who's the guru of delirium, what the diagnosis parts of delirium. That needs to be medically evaluated then. If you have a change, you can't wait till tomorrow, you can't wait till, you know, the doctor's going to be in a few days. They have to be evaluated right away because it can be something as serious as a heart attack or a stroke, or it can be constipation, but it's changing the behavior and they're delirious now and something has to be done now. So goals of care is important. In this case, I'll just say quickly, an 83-year-old woman with end-stage emphysema is restrained to keep her oxygen on her, and she's thrashing and confused. You know, and I can see them giving Haldol and Ativan. Basically, she's got end-stage disease. She needs morphine, she needs hospice, and to be untied. When you tie people up, I don't tie up anyone, no one. Tying up people makes them more agitated. And what I do is I like beanbag chairs. I like reclining chairs for folks who can't walk. I like one-on-one caregivers. I like low beds and mats. So the behavioral and psychological symptoms of dementia can be broken down into 3 categories. This is why this is just not an easy situation. I can't just talk about use antipsychotics or not. It's much bigger than that. You need to know what are the exact symptoms. Is it delusion, psychosis, and paranoia? That's in the kind of like schizophrenia category. Is it mood lability? Do they get really angry? You know, I had one guy with alcoholic dementia who would be starting talking about his ex-wife like this. And so we wouldn't talk about his ex-wife fairly much. And then there's the depression, you know, and standard depression is kind of sad and withdrawn, but I have found that in dementia, you can be irritable, you can be too angry, it's some frontal lobe changes. But that they get better with antidepressants. And so I'd much rather use a little bit of Celexa at night, maybe 5 or 10, or a little bit of gabapentin, which is, that is not study supported, the gabapentin. But the side effects are much less than even using the Ativan. Do you know how many studies are out there about how to correctly use Ativan in dementia? How many think there are more than 5 studies in all the literature about using Ativan in dementia? There's one. It's not studied, and we doctors use it as a default, and I'm here to say that's wrong. I'm gonna go one beyond Tony and say, I don't see a big role for sleeping pills or Ativan or the benzos in use of dementia. So the neuroleptics. I'm not going to go into this really deeply. At my website, elderconsult.com, it's on the last page. I have a whole section written in English about the psychoactive medications, some of the benefits and some of the side effects. And basically the biggies are Haldol, Risperdal, Olanzapine, and Seroquel. They have the 2% increased stroke risk and the 1% increased sudden death risk. They can cause stiffening. They can cause falls. They will cause decline. So I totally agree with Tony on this point that they should be reduced. And I will go one further than Tony on this, is that if someone has been on, if they've been bipolar or if they've been on psych meds for many years, I still would continue to try and decrease the dose. Now, I've decreased the dose and then someone's like hauled off and hit their roommate thinking they were going to try and kill them in their sleep, that person needs their meds back. But particularly as they get sicker, as they get frailer, I would still work to decrease the dose. And I always start with the antipsychotics and the Depakote first, and then the last ones I leave on are the antidepressants and the gabapentin. Parkinson's disease, I'm just going to skip through this because you can get the main points out of these. Parkinson's disease is special. Never use Haldol, never use Risperdal. That's going to freeze them up completely. Basically try and avoid anticholinergics. Give them something that's anticholinesterase inhibitor-like, like Namenda and Aricept. If they have threatening, and I've tried to change this several times, not treatment, threatening psychotic behavior, you might try a little bit of Seroquel or Clozapine. Because, you know, the dirty little secret is that some of the behaviors in dementia are from the brain damage. They can cause paranoia. They can cause serious aggression. I've had one of my patients who was in one of the counties. He was put in my facility, tried to escape and climb the walls. I asked to use the Depakote. He hadn't been conserved yet. I discussed it with the patient. I was asked by the court to use Ativan. I was like, no, I'm not going to use Ativan. That's going to be more disinhibiting. Think of Ativan, think of a shot of vodka. Are you going to give your clients a shot of vodka? I did use the Depakote. The judge came back and said, well, you know, I know he's doing, and the guy settled in. He really enjoyed the people he was with. He could hold court, and even though he couldn't say more than a sentence or two, he had his social graces, and he was doing really well. The court said, no, he needs to have the least restrictive environment possible. They sent him home with a friend to a home, and he was back within 3 weeks, and within a couple days after that, he was sent out 5150 because he tried to smother and kick his roommate. So some of these people do need these medications. They are dangerous, and Tony, you know, and I are in agreement that you try everything else first, but that, you know, there are behaviors. Where I would differ is I don't see them as how you would address babies. I see them as, you know, we want to keep their dignity. I do think that people in nursing homes are starved for touch. I think they need engagement. I think they need engagement, and there's different dementias. I mean, you can't, with someone who's got vascular dementia, you can't have them do, you know, kind of just bingo and kind of the, you know, let's read the newspaper to everyone. You need to have high-level engagement for them at the moment that they won't remember 10 minutes later. It's not easy. So, sundowning. Basically, this was another study from 2011. Basically, it's screening, delusional thinking, paranoia that often happens later in the afternoon and evening. And basically, they found that the treatments that worked best were engagement, light therapy. Basically, keep people moving, keep them engaged. Aricept, melatonin, behavioral interventions, and antipsychotics. I'm done.
Just before I start, a couple of issues I take with your talk, Tony. Why practice medicine legislatively? Well, as much as we don't like it there, I agree that we need to do that. Because ultimately, in some ways, by us knowing the law, we need to always readdress our practice and make it better. So I'm not going to argue with that, although I don't like the statement. Medication should not should reduce disability. No, they're not going to reduce disability in someone with a progressive disease. So the function will continue to decline regardless. Yes, some medications can worsen that disability and over-sedate. I also don't agree that the use of drugs represents a failure. Just as Dr. Landsverk alluded to, definitely do need to use drugs at times, and there's some very serious cases, situations we deal with in the community. So I work with a geriatrics team for outpatient care, but a lot of our work involves day-to-day case management of people with dementia who reside with their spouse or other caregiver in their home, in an assisted living facility, which could be a huge one, or a small boarding care. By the time they go into a nursing home, or as the VA calls them, community living center, we usually are not involved at that point because medical care should be provided there. Another hand. Okay. So I've kind of, over the years, because I've had so many what I would call very sad situations to deal with on a day-to-day, every single day, sometimes takes up all of the day's basis, I've wanted to look, given my palliative care background, at the concept of suffering. You see a definition up there. And of course, people with dementia, especially those with behavioral disturbances, are suffering. There's no doubt about it. We see it. Anybody, I think, will agree to that. And how do we go about alleviating suffering or determine that we have alleviated the suffering of that person, given that they can't always communicate as we would like them to? On the other hand, the caregiver, whether it be spouse or friend or whoever the caregiver is also suffering because they're seeing their loved one in a state that they never expected to see them in. Other people suffering in this picture are the hired caregivers at times who don't know or don't have the training or whatever the situation is to deal with this ongoing chronic suffering on a day-to-day basis. Need to put on my glasses. Well, this is sort of how we would break down the key points from the case study that Terry presented at the beginning for a 76-year-old Filipino woman who resided in this assisted living facility for 2 years. We don't know the size of the facility, how many residents live there. Her diagnosis of dementia was in 2009, and prior to that, in her earlier years, she did have a high-profile job and was a person who liked to stay at home. She also, when she started to get ill, did not want to have caregivers in her home, and she was started on donepezil, which seemed to decrease her anger. Then she started to argue more. She was placed in assisted living and started on lorazepam, unfortunately. She had a history of sleep problems, put on a sleeping pill, Zolpidem, and she sleeps a lot during the day, but recently she started to get, her behavior started to escalate with kicking, hitting, yelling, and they seemed to worsen these behaviors when she bathed or when she went to, was taken to the dining room or to activities. She was started on a quetiapine and she fell, and she was eating less, she's quieter, but for the staff she was easier to manage. Obviously they didn't like the hitting, kicking, and yelling. But her family was concerned about too much sleeping during the daytime. We'll just take a little break looking here now at the American Geriatric Society guidelines for 2013 on the general treatment principles for behavior. And just as Dr. Landsverk and Tony both alluded to, you want to identify and treat physical illness that's going on. They advise promoting brain health, which we hear about in general, for everybody and every illness. Exercise, eat well, and reduce your stress. Wish it were easier to do. Avoid medications that have anticholinergic side effects. Antihistamines do have anticholinergic side effects, and there's many, many others. Set realistic goals. Limit as needed use for psychotropic medication. This is a big one, and we'll get a little more into that, because when we give an as-needed dose of any medication, we're relying on somebody to know when that dose is needed, right? Most often, the resident doesn't know, and many times the staff think they know, so that can be a problem. We always want to specify and quantify what our target behaviors want to be and maximize and maintain functioning. In our clinics, we want to, and everywhere else, obviously, we should try to maintain and establish an alliance with the family or whoever the patient says that their family is. In hospice, the unit of care is the patient and the family, and so is it when a person has an advanced dementia disease. The patient usually isn't alone. It's about the patient and the family as the unit of care. Considering referral to hospice when end-stage dementia is evident, and usually by that time the behaviors have dissipated, and unfortunately the next step is not a happy one. We want to look at the context of the behaviors. AGS recommends this, and look for triggers. Exclude physical discomfort and consider non-pharmacological strategies. AGS also says that to improve function, we should modify behaviors, schedule toileting, and that's a big one, grade the assistants, and Dr. Landsberg spoke about TIPA smell tapes. She shows how to try to maintain independence for as long as possible. Even letting a person with dementia doing whatever they can is helpful in their dignity and in maintaining their function for as long as possible. Positive reinforcement is key. For problem behaviors, I think we're going to have a whole talk this afternoon on issues related to that. Music helps with some, not all people, but it can be very effective, and I'm just going to let you read the rest of it. So the questions that were asked are, what steps would you advise the assisted living team to take in the initial approach with this resident? Understand that a lot of... Okay, thank you. You set the eyes here. You work with the facilities or the family, usually through clinic visits, but also a lot by phone and faxes. So this is an outpatient approach. So the first step when we start to get reports of difficult behavior, on my part, will be to try to learn how the assisted living facility works. Who are the staff? Who's on duty? How many caregivers? Are there new caregivers? How well trained are those caregivers? And that's a big, big issue to take a whole talk just on that. How well does the geriatrics team or the primary care provider know the patient and the family and the goals of care and the patient-family preferences? This is very important. We try to find out through all these ways of communication why this person has started the kicking, the hitting, the yelling, and just as both previous speakers alluded to, we're going to look at issues such as pain, UTI, ear infection, constipation, poor management of other health issues, for instance, diabetes. Do they have a new roommate? Roommates can be a challenge. Changes in staffing, weight loss, dental problems, new medications that have been started, boredom, lack of privacy, sensory impairment. Sensory impairment is very, very important. We use a lot of pocket talkers. Dr. Landsverk mentioned that. Hearing loss is a big issue, as is vision loss in older people, and we need to be aware of that and try to help people always have their glasses, their hearing aids, or a pocket talker. Dr. Tenover, who's in the audience, who heads our geriatrics team, has taught me, and certainly we all agree, that it's better to have one quarterback, not to have 10 or 6 or 4 primary care providers in the mix, because then the right hand doesn't agree with the left, the family gets very confused, lots of orders are being written, and there's very little continuity of care. Also, we have a resident of patients at our clinic who say, well, didn't my other doctor call you about what happened? Didn't you get the report? Well, it doesn't work that way yet in this ideal and real world. So that's something we need to focus on. As I mentioned before, a lot of the contact with the staff is via fax or phone, and it's important. And I do try to establish a relationship with the key staff members working with the resident who's having a problem, and not to rely on a fax report. And most of the fax reports I get are like, patient agitated at 2 p.m. Very helpful, right? Really helpful. Or patient hit roommate at 4 p.m. Advise medication. I'm not joking, these are typical, really, really typical. So we need to find out more when this occurs and really be proactive, which is why it's wonderful to work with a team, you know, where you're not just a provider operating alone. Also, the development of trust with the facility we work with and with the family and with the patient is very key. And this happens early on as we get to know the patient and start to communicate with who I find out at the facility is the key player. I'm probably going to go over time, but anyway. What is the geriatrics interdisciplinary team? Okay. So as you can see, it's up there in front of you. And as I mentioned before, these are complex patients. And so we need to look at the patient and the family as the unit of care. So the geriatrician manages the medications and the health issues along with the advanced practice nurse. A social worker manages family support or caregiver stress burden, guidance for resources, behavior management, and long-term planning. Psychology provides assessment of cognitive status, depression, anxiety, and therapy if needed. And although those roles are not distinct roles, there's always a lot of crossover in all these roles, which is why when there are teams that work together well, they're not static. The team members have to work at developing the team, trusting each other, and not saying, you know, I own that, you don't own that, and get out of my way kind of issue. They need to work on those issues of constantly developing the team. The focus of the team, however, is to provide a high level of quality care in accordance with the patient and the family's preferences. So how would we work with the clinical team and the family to manage Mrs. X's care? Well, she was seen, for example, at our clinic with her daughter 2 months before, and she was stable. She wasn't hitting and kicking at the time. But her cognitive status had declined. We did a brief cognitive assessment, the Montreal cognitive assessment, and her score dropped a bit from 15 out of 30 to 12 out of 30. She's in the moderate range of dementia. Now the daughter did report at the time that her mother sometimes moaned a little when they got her up from bed or a chair, but when Mrs. X was asked, she denied having any pain. And sometimes you don't say you have pain, you say, are you hurting? You know, other ways to try and there's a bunch of pain assessment tools. But since the visit, in the past month, we started to get a lot of faxes coming in reporting her increased agitation with kicking, yelling, and hitting. Daughter called me and telling me that Mrs. X would have to be moved out of the facility if her behaviors were not managed, and this happens often. Sad to say that this happens fairly often. And when not managed, usually that means put them on medication and sedate them as much as you can. The daughter was tearful and didn't know what to do. There were lots of discussions on the phone with the staff, trying to get more information. We always want to see what are the triggers for the behavior. What happened to set off the behavior? What's the antecedent that preceded the behavior? Like taking her to the dining room seemed to set her off, or bringing her to bed seemed to set her off. And then what happened after the behaviors occurred, after she kicked or yelled? Was she somehow maybe rewarded, you know, to try to calm her down? We asked the staff about nonverbal and verbal signs of pain, and we looked for infection, some cause of UTI or coughing or something else going on, and what were her sleep habits, and what kind of activities did the facility offer to Mrs. X? So looking at this, these were some of the solutions. The arrow is there. Okay, fine. About the behavior. So we put her on standing order of Tylenol 3 times a day, since we wanted to see if the pain was a contributing factor. We did give her some trazodone at bedtime, which we often do use in our clinics. Or we could have started an SSRI. We asked the daughter to take her out and visit an adult day healthcare program in the community for some more activities. And we encourage the staff to limit the daytime napping. Don't let her sleep too long during the day. Wake her up. Daughter brought in a box of photos at our recommendation, because people often like to sift through a box, shoebox full of old photos, brings back pleasant memories. So that was included. And tried putting Mrs. X in a smaller table with only one other resident at dining time. We also encouraged her daughter to attend our caregiver support group and learn more about dementia. And we requested feedback from the facility staff and responded to them in a timely fashion. Over time, we did need to increase the dose of trazodone. But we did need to keep her on the Seroquel for a while because the behavior still continues. Again, this is one case study. So, the real and the ideal. Bottom line is that many people with dementia have behavioral challenges that do require a medication such as a typical antipsychotic for a while, despite our best attempts to avoid this. We don't want to randomly prescribe. We want complete history. We want to know what's going on. We didn't like her being on the Razepam, and that's on the beers list of not recommended for the elderly. But there are times we do use them, just as Dr. Landsverk said, in the short term, and they can be effective for certain behaviors. But we generally do not use that. Behavior modifications are to be tried first and always continue, no matter what medication is implemented. And we always want to document any responses to behaviors, of course informed consent, how we monitor the behaviors, how we're meeting the objective. Example, she will agree to bathe 3 times a week, a measurable goal. No two people are alike. We have to look at each person with dementia as a person with dementia. We do avoid, do not give PRN medications in facilities, because that over-sedate the patient, and often the staff cannot determine the need for this, and they may over-medicate. And we always want to address the side effects if we use an atypical extrapyramidal symptom, metabolic syndrome. We'll need to look at that. Communicating is always the key. Managing a person with challenging behaviors in dementia is an art and a science. And that's very important to remember. And documentation of all our efforts is so important, especially in our litigated society. So this is something I just put together, given that this is what we tend to do in our clinics. There's a lot of variability on this. The arrows can go up and down, but the key message to take home from this is that educate the caregiver, regardless who the caregiver is, be it the wife, be it the adult child, be it the staff member. It's an ongoing issue that must be constantly encouraged and provided. Document everything that is discussed or started as to the rationale, as to the discussion with the family member, as why you're giving the medication. If we do need to incorporate an atypical antipsychotic, we want to discuss the black box warning, we want to discuss everything we've tried, review what has worked, what has not, and why we're moving to that step. But all along the way, we're going to be utilizing non-pharmacological interventions. And we need to start to cut back on atypicals, should we add them every couple of months, and see if there is improvement and we can pull the person off it. The evidence is that there is a lot of relapse when people are taken off an atypical. Nonetheless, that is our goal. Our goal is to eliminate medications, not start them if we don't have to. Unfortunately, the complex cases we see do often require them, and we want people to be calmer and have some dignity in their lives, and they decline. Thank you.
So, for Tippy, what safety issues would you look for in this resident's case, and how would you advocate for the resident and her family?
First of all, I want to commend my colleagues here who pretty much touched on everything, including what I'm going to say. But I think it doesn't hurt to hear this more than once. The safety issues. First concern is whether or not she is a danger to herself or others in the facility. On the surface, she does not appear to be. However, if she is hitting and kicking staff, that could escalate to the point that she is indeed a danger to others, and that would need to be dealt with at the time. I would not recommend at this stage that it is a huge issue, but I think it must be addressed. One of the things that came to me when I read this is, don't force the client to do something. If she's objecting, don't make her do it. And it seemed that they were taking her to bath and basically kicking. Well, if she's hitting and kicking, don't bathe her. If the resident is truly resistant, then back away. In extreme cases, when she does become a danger to herself or others, then obviously she would have to be 5150. But that we would not recommend that unless it's really an extreme case. And hopefully the police wouldn't do it unless it was an extreme case. I'm going to gloss through quite a few of these things because I only have 10 minutes, so I'm going to get through this pretty quickly. How would I advocate for the resident and her family? First of all, there needs to be a complete psychosocial history on file for her, and that's already been touched on. And I put down just a couple of issues here, what we already know from the story. That she was a top executive in a successful firm. One of the things we don't know is, how does she predominantly communicate, in English or Tagalog? Or one of the dialects from the Philippines, maybe. She tends to be a loner, we know that. We know her current speaking patterns. We know how long she'd be in the facility. These are just a few of the things that we know, but the idea is to develop a full psychosocial history. And then to go back, what we don't know, and again, this is just a small smattering of what we don't know, what are her past sleeping patterns like? So the surface of the story, we don't have that information. Have they changed? Types of activities she's engaged in the past, does she engage in any at the moment? Is she involved in any activities in the facility? What are they offering? If it's only bingo, maybe that's a problem. Does she have family? Number of children? None of this is indicated. She has family, but we don't know the extent of the family. I mean, what are the kinship relationships in the family? These are very important aspects because that will also tell you how the decision making is going to be made. What are her hobbies and interests in the past? What has she been interested in? She's obviously been an extremely active, engaged woman on the professional level. What did she do socially? How long has she been in the USA? Where did she go to school, to college? How long has she lived alone? All these are important aspects. I know there's much, much more. We can develop long lists of what we need to know about her, but there needs to be a thorough psychosocial history in her files. Next slide. There also needs to be a thorough physical assessment, and my colleagues have talked about this fairly extensively. We need to rule out some of the more obvious things. physical pain, oral pain, it's often missed. People don't look at oral pain or oral hygiene as being an issue. But you should know that 70% of weight loss in facilities is attributed to poor oral hygiene. So be aware of that, because this may be a contributing factor here. And of course, infection we talked about. There are many other things. Hydration was talked about. Lots and lots of possibilities that we can rule out right from the top, which need to be dealt with. Okay, now as an ombudsman, this is really, in my opinion, the heart and the soul of caregiving is about consistent caregiving or consistent caregivers. Find out which caregivers relate well to her and assign them to her consistently, so that she's always dealing with the same team. Morning, noon, night, and weekends. That every weekend she's dealing with the same people. Every night she gets the same people. And if there are floaters that come in when somebody's absent, make sure they're the same floaters that come in, that she's always dealing with the same team, and that they're very familiar with her and she with them. Consistent caregivers lead to better knowledge of the resident, which leads to building strong relationships between client and caregivers, and better care. And I'm going to give you an example. This is the heart of what we call resident-focused care. Dr. Bill Thomas, some of you may know of him, some of you may not, but he is the person behind a particular philosophy around resident-centered care called the Eden Alternative. And from that, there's an extension called the Greenhouse Project, which is a new model for nursing homes. And I was watching a movie that he had developed on the first Greenhouse Project that they had, and they had IDT, and Betty referred to what an interdisciplinary team meeting is. So you've got all the disciplines that are there treating the client are present, and they're in a circle, and the CNA, the Certified Nursing Assistant, comes in with the client into the circle. The client is in a wheelchair, she's nonverbal, she's been in nursing home for a very long time. And the team has their meeting, and somewhere in the middle of the meeting, the CNA gets up and wheels the resident out and comes back 15, 20 minutes later. And at the end of the meeting, the physician says to her, "What was that about? Why did you leave?" And she said, "Well, we've had her here for 6 months now, and I'm really getting to know her well. When she came, she was diabetic. She was considered to be incontinent. But she may be nonverbal, but I actually began to realize that she does cue me when she needs to go to the bathroom. She taps her fingers on the table or on the side of the wheelchair, or she taps her foot on the floor. And when she does that, I know I need to take her to the bathroom. We don't die for her anymore." So that's what I'm talking about, this consistent caregiving, and the relationships that form between the caregivers and the residents are profound. They really get to know each other on a very, very intimate level. So that's an example of that I'm trying to rush through because I only got 10 minutes. This resident may require time spent alone. She has a history of doing that. And in that time spent alone, what does she normally do at home when she's spending time alone? Music was one of the things that we talked about. Does she like opera? We have a resident in one of our facilities now who loves opera. So my ombudsman takes in videotapes of operas. Is that what she likes? Find out what she likes. What does she have a history of liking? Does she like old-time movies? Maybe she likes sci-fi. I mean, whatever it is, find out and make sure she gets it, particularly in the time she spent alone. Perhaps she likes sewing, and can she still sew? I mean, these are things you need to find out about this woman to be able to make that quality time for her. This is another thing that's being touched on. And of course, with 10 minutes, I'm barely touching the surface of anything. Do not, and I'm talking about training staff, and training must be ongoing and often. It needs to just be a continual event that's happening. Do not engage in an argument. I mean, that must be the very basics of training. Don't engage in arguing with the resident. If the resident is argumentative, come back later. What are your facility policies about this stuff? Facility policies and procedures are very, very important in how you deal with situations. And they'll give your staff the guidelines to do that. Now, obviously, they have to be able to think on their feet, too, and circumvent some of the policies when necessary. But they're certainly a good starting point. Refusal of care. I'm on the right slide?
Yes.
Refusal of care. If consistently refusing, have somebody else come and try. Focus on the resident, not on the task. It's okay to come back a little while later to change a resident. Let the resident dictate the time. It's not okay to leave the resident for hours and hours in the wet diaper. Caregivers should examine his or her body language and their tone of voice. If a resident comes in and there are four call bells ringing, and the resident, at least not the caregiver, comes in and there's two or three or four call bells coming in, and she's needed in another room, she's going to herself be in a hurry. She's going to be somewhat agitated, in a hurry, I need to get this done. This resident is resisting again, what am I going to do? That's going to show in body language and tone of voice. So be sure that the caregivers know to check all that before they enter a room, because residents that have dementia are extremely susceptible to body language and tone of voice. What is the sex of the caregiver? You know, I know one thing now, I'm not in a facility yet, but don't give me a male to bathe me. I know that. And I'll put that down when I'm ready to go into a facility. If you've got male caregivers that are providing care to females, they may object, and they may not know how to say that to you. So it's up to you to figure that out. You've got to find out whether this is acceptable or not. Some people have no problems with it at all. I've got a couple of examples here. Again, going back to facilities, now you can't leave it. I got a call midnight. Actually, I think it was 1 a.m. And it's from a nursing home, and the nursing home is very agitated. The staff person was very agitated. We have a resident here who's on hospice. She's really right towards the end days of her life. Her niece is with her. Her niece spends a lot of time here and is with her right now. And she won't allow us to give us the pain medication that we have to give her before we can change her. She is in so much pain that the doctor has given us a prescription that we're supposed to administer half an hour before we change her diaper. We've been struggling with this woman for 4 hours to give her the pain meds, and the niece is not allowing us to do that. So they put the niece on the phone, and I have a conversation with the niece, and the niece was saying she feels that her aunt would want to process her death. And when they put her on pain medications, she's not able to do the processing. And so the niece, who knows the aunt very well and has been very loving and very attentive to this aunt, is not allowing the caregiver to give the medications. And there was nothing that I could do or say to her. I was on the phone with her for about an hour. And finally I said to her, we're going to have to call in the police. And I called the local police station. I explained the situation to them, asked them if they would please escort the woman out of the room long enough to allow the pain medications to be given, and then to wait until that had kicked in, and wait until the resident had been changed, and then to allow the niece to go back in the room. That seemed to me at the time to be the most appropriate thing to do. I didn't want to separate the niece and her aunt from any time that they may have together, and there was obviously a lot of affection between them. So you're going to have to think on your feet with some of these things and do what you have to do. The yelling and the shouting out. Having consistent caregivers helps with this because they know how to divert the resident. They may know how to divert the resident. They may not always know. And of course, again, you want to look at rule out all the indicators for pain and whatever else, but that's a given for everything. Dr. Power came to the last Alzheimer's conference and spoke. And I think he was either the last one or the one before that, and he was very powerful and has some very, very powerful stories. And he tells the story about a man who, after dinner every night, will jump up and start yelling, give me a line, give me a line, give me a line. Well, most of us know that a lot of clients with Alzheimer's or even dementia will focus in on a phrase or a word and just repeat it over and over and over again, and people don't necessarily know what they're trying to say. So they had kind of put this down to his dementia, but it went on and on and on. It was always the same words and always at the same time of the day, 6 o'clock in the evening or after dinner at night. give me a line, give me a line. Finally, they started to do some psychosocial research. And in talking to his wife, this man had been a high-powered executive in a Fortune 500 company, and he traveled a lot. And no matter where he was in the world, at 6 o'clock in the evening, her time, he called her. And it was usually after dinner, her time. And now, of course, he's in the same time zone, so after dinner, her time is after dinner, his time. He wanted a phone. And once they figured that out, they gave him a phone, helped him dial his wife, and he was as happy as Larry. Be careful of how you label people. He's not problematic. He's not a yeller or a screamer. He's got an issue, and it needs to be dealt with, and the only way he knows to do with it is to yell. There's another story of a man in a facility who would wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning and run for the door. He wanted out. And he was labeled as a wanderer. This guy has now developed wandering tendencies. He wants to get out. But again, when they worked on the psychosocial history, they found that he was a former firefighter. His family said he's a firefighter. Tell him if this is a false alarm. So they did. And he went back to bed. So again, you know, is this problematic behavior, or is there an actual reason behind it that you can figure out and then deal with that? But it's all about communication and learning about your client. 1 minute. Have I got 1 minute? I'm done. Oh, okay, sorry. Let's go to bathing. How many of you have seen the movie Bathing Without a Battle? Quite a few of you. It is absolutely a remarkable movie. There is no reason to have any struggle with bathing if you watch that movie. And if you haven't watched it, we have a copy in our facility. You may borrow it from us, but we're going to ask for a deposit when you borrow it, because we've lost 3 copies already that weren't returned. So we'll ask for a deposit, and we'll give you back the deposit when we get it back. But it's available, and they show that the alternative to bathing in a shower is to actually bed bath. Just do a bed bath. And who's to say that the facility policy says the resident will get two baths a week, or two showers a week, or 3 showers a week? So what? The resident doesn't want 3 showers a week. Take your cue from the resident. There are a couple of facilities that we have in San Mateo that have implemented spas. And the one woman in one of these places is really cute. Each resident is assigned, I think it's once a week, or maybe it's once every 2 weeks, spa time. And they get a little shoulder massage. First of all, they take them from the room. They're undressed in their rooms. A terry robe is put on them, and they either wheel or walk down to the bathing area, the spa. There's aromatherapy going on with candles. The towels are on a rail that heats the towels. They can either get into the bath, you know, those special baths which you have the little doors that open and close. They can either get in and soak in a tub, or they can have a shower, whichever they prefer. But it's a very special time. And then when they come out, they're wrapped with the warm towels, and they take them back to their rooms. Do you think they don't like that? Do you think they're going to fight to have that done? I mean, they love that. That's an experience they love. And this one woman has made an absolute ritual of it. So when it's her turn to have, when it's her spa day, she has them come to her beforehand, and they bring her a cookie and a cup of tea, and she sits and relaxes, and she has that after she's been put to her terry robe. And then they take her down to the spa, and it's a total ritual with her. She loves it. I don't think they're going to fight if you did something special like that. Compare that to this experience that I had, walking down a nursing home with very large corridors, and I noticed a line of residents on the side, all wrapped in sheets and naked under the sheets, sitting in shower chairs, with their butts, of course, hanging down underneath that you could see. I mean, really undignified. And I'm walking down and I'm looking at this, and the next thing is a door behind me. They're lined up on the right-hand side, and a door behind me on the left-hand side flings open, and out comes a CNA pushing a shower chair, hands a male CNA, wheels this shower chair out. The woman's wrapped now in a towel, passes it over to another CNA, yells, "Next." Somebody from that facility went into the administration and said, "I feel like I'm if any of you have experienced cattle going into a cattle..."